Welcome to the podcast on music, art and culture. I'm your host, Matthijs de Bruin. This episode's guest is installation artist Emma van Noort. Emma and I have been friends for a long time and we often talk about art. Even though this is a really polite conversation, I think the fact that we know each other really well helps to take away some of the inhibition and allows us to spar with ideas a little more freely. I'm very happy to have Emma van Noort on the podcast. So you're an artist and you are creative, and I was wondering, when did it start to manifest?
Well, I think it was just always there.
From an early age?
Yeah. Yeah, for as long as I can remember, I've been making things.
Can you tell me the story about your paper shoe?
Oh yeah, of course. When I was a kid, I would come up with solutions. I would sort of I couldn't really play on my own, but when I did, I was inventive. Mm. And at some point, I made my own shoes out of A4 paper, like the printing paper, and I just put my foot on there, and then I would just cut around it, and I came up with ways that it would stick to my feet, and then I would walk outside on paper shoes. And I don't know why I did that. I think I wanted to have some sandals, and I saw the paper and I just made it.
Pretty amazing for a small child too. Being able to imagine how something has to be made.
Well, I think that's it. When I see something, and that's something that I still have, and as a child I would have, I had it as well, that I would invent a way to make it. So it's like unfolding a box, or an unfolded box, and imagining it how it will be a box. If you understand, like a layout.
So, before we started recording this, we had a conversation similar to this, and you told me you couldn't play with Lego because it was too damned in. It's too limited for you as a kid. And now you just added to that you were always able to imagine how something had to be made.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably linked to each other, that Lego was not imaginative enough.
I think so.
It's too formalized.
And I'm so used to, I mean, you had the instructions and my brother would always build what was in the instruction, and that was the his way of playing.
Yeah.
And for me, it was like I would build something and all of a sudden I realized that I run out of red bricks and I couldn't play anymore because I wanted to make like a red sculpture I don't know. It was too, I think it's a cliche, but for example, if we have something from IKEA, I would lay out all the parts and figure out how it would go together. And Lars is going to read, my boyfriend is going to read the instructions and tells me how it is. And we end up not really fighting. We have different approaches,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah, that's a good thing to have fights about in a relationship. Many people do that.
Yeah, of course.
And it's so silly because it's just a different way of operating.
Yeah.
And it's so hard for people to look outside of their way of operating. Like your example as a kid, how you could imagine sandals from a sheet of paper. That's the way you operate. And as a kid, you couldn't step outside of that and play with Lego by building something from an instruction.
Yeah. Yeah, also, we have to make a jump in time, but when I graduated, I wanted to build a wooden structure, but it had to be delicate.
Yeah.
But it also had to be big. And a lot of times my dad and I would go to the to the hardware store and just have discussions, because my dad would say, no, this is going to come down. It will not hold. Yeah. It will fall apart. And I was like, yeah, but I really like this material and it looks good. And it's quite nice, because he taught me how to be more practical.
Mm.
But he also really understands that not every piece of wood is good enough for the artwork.
Yeah.
And always when I think of something, we would discuss about how I'm going to build it, and I would. It's nice to have these more practical minds to consult. Yeah.
One thing we just went over, and I realized it's related to something else, is we talked about how you as a child you had one way of operating, and you couldn't really get outside of that, and then I realized, oh, there's part of the inevitability of becoming an artist, because it's just who you are, and people cannot operate outside of who they are.
No, well, people do, but yeah.
Well, I had this funny, this interesting conversation with the mentor person of my art university a half year ago when I went back. I just bumped into her in the hallway. And we talked about how pliable life actually is. And life seems sort of infinitely malleable, pliable. And but it's only malleable, I think is the word. Maakbaar. Malleable. It's only malleable as far as your personality allowed for it. For example, I could try to study mathematics, but I'm really not gifted in that department, and become a famous mathematician, but I can't.
Yeah.
So that's just a no-go. I can't. And also, I'm not the most diligent person, so I couldn't I couldn't excel at a job that requires super high levels of diligence. Because it's just not in my personality to be really good at that. So there are limits. And I asked you before, why don't you quit being an artist? And I think in there's part of the answer, because it's just who you are, it's the way you function.
Yeah, I think a lot of people who didn't officially become an artist still have the. Maybe it's not being an artist is not who you are. It's more being creative is part of your character.
Yeah, the way you function.
Yeah, and you have really creative mathematicians.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Sure. We went to the same high school, and I remember in high school you were so certain of the fact that you had to become an artist, or that you had to make art, mainly.
Yeah.
Why were you so certain of that?
I was just really focused on going to art school. And when I graduated art school, I was like, now what? What's the next step?
Yeah.
Because then you have like a sort of emptiness.
Yeah.
Like, you have to figure out how to be one, I think. I don't know, it was on preschool? Is preschool the right?
No, we have elementary school and high school in the Netherlands.
Yeah,
so
I think it was in elementary school that I decided I had to choose the high school, and I chose the high school where you could combine art school with, you could take classes at the art school.
Yeah.
So I chose that high school so that I could combine it. And I, at second grade, I knew that there was someone giving a lecture about art And he was from the art school, so I grabbed all my best drawings and I created a small portfolio and I just went there. Yeah. I was maybe 13 or something. And I asked if I could apply for art schools. And it was years later that I realized that I didn't have to apply, that I didn't have to show a portfolio.
Okay.
You could just go there if your grades were okay.
Mm.
And it was more for people, like an extra thing, not really for people who actually wanted to go to art school. So yeah, but it shows how serious I took it
yeah.
at that age already. And I just really wanted to do that. I couldn't... I don't know, I cannot really remember a time that I decided. It was just, I wanted to do that, and I, yeah.
So, as a child, it was natural to do it.
Yeah.
And I guess it still is.
Yeah. I cannot imagine myself not having an art practice.
No. So, But still, that doesn't necessarily mean you have to take the difficult path of being a professional artist.
No, but the more time I want to spend on art, the more serious I have to take it. Because if it's just a hobby,
mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I don't... There's a professional... the being professional is maybe you can put it in two parts. People would think that it's you're professional if you make money.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily my goal. If
it's also not necessarily a realistic goal.
No, that's that as well. It's just if I But the more money I can make with my art, the more art I can make.
Yeah. So, just before you brought up the money part, I wanted to ask you, if you take the money part out of being a professional artist and just disregard money at all, what is for you the added value of engaging with art in a professional way over, or what is the difference between being an artist for life over being an artist as a side thing, as a hobby?
Because I want to get better. So
why? There are many people that have hobbies and they want to be really good at them. Some people yeah. are really good at their hobbies.
But it's the difference between a hobby or being professional is the amount of time you can spend on it. And this is my first goal. It's just the top priority. And everything else is just to facilitate it.
Okay. So why is it so important that you're willing to schedule your whole life around it?
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know.
So 2 days a week wouldn't be enough?
No. Sometimes.
Okay.
Sometimes I don't go to my studio for 2 weeks, and sometimes I'll be there every day.
Hmm. Interesting.
But it's always in my mind.
Yeah, that's for me. That's the same thing. I'm asking you these questions because, especially recently, I'm really asking these questions myself. Like, how is that for me? So why wouldn't I be just an amateur? And I suspect. And the answer is, the part of the answer is something like, because the part of you that is the part that makes you want to be a creative is bigger than a hobby would be in your life.
Well, I think we are just talking about the role it would have. So it doesn't really matter if you are... If you are professional or not, it's just that it's just my my main goal. So if it's a hobby, but I could do that hobby full time, it would be a hobby for me.
Yeah.
But I have to do it professional, because then I can spend more time.
Mm. I think maybe I wonder what you think about this. The reason that we have to do it sort of full time is because when you do what you do in your daily life, you are it's basically your life is self-development. Everything you do is developing parts of you, and the part that we need to develop, because that's where our talent is, our creative part, and therefore we need to be creative as much of the time as possible.
Yeah.
And I think that's why we are so stubborn as to pursue an art career.
Well, maybe, but it's also, I mean, now we make it sound like I can spend a lot of time as an artist, and I mean, in order to facilitate it, I have to have a job on the side, mm-hmm. and I have to make money in a different way, and I sometimes I'm not able to spend time on my art because I have to work. Mm. But most of that money goes into my practice again.
Yeah.
Sometimes I have to save up for an artwork, or I mean, it's not, sometimes I'm just not able to spend that much time on my art practice, but everything I do is to facilitate it.
It sounds kind of like how religious people are about their church or the congregation, whatever they're part of, because they also, every time they have outside of work, they spend on their that one thing.
Yeah, but maybe it's also a part of you.
Mm.
It's not that you're only religious on Sunday.
No.
So, yeah, it's a part of you, and it's but then it would be really impractical if you would be in church all the time, because, yeah. How do you get food, and yes. How can you have a home, and yeah, of course there are people who go to that extreme, but well, never mind, that's another story.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know, it's just it's part of you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good analogy. So I would also like to ask you some things about your art itself.
Yeah.
Because that's interesting. So you mentioned before that when you tried to make a big wooden framework that was both elegant and... No, you didn't use the word elegant. You said something else. Timid. And stable. You had to...
Delicate.
Delicate, yeah, that was it. Delicate and stable. You went to the hardware store with your dad and sort of... try to figure out how to make it work and still be delicate. And that's when I immediately thought, oh, that's sort of a form and function discussion.
Yeah.
Hey, that's interesting. And because within arts, that's more usually discussed as the... being the art itself, the form of the art and the function of the art. But I was like, hey, so there's an artistic part to that and a functional part to that, a practical part.
Yeah.
And I thought it was so interesting that you just mentioned it, and I was wondering, so how does the practical and the aesthetic manifest in your work? Is that a constant struggle?
No, it's not really a struggle. It's more of a collaboration between the two, I think.
Interesting.
So I would, usually I'm inspired by the material.
Mm.
So that's where it starts. I can imagine different kind of materials together.
Mm.
And I think my practice is more also more material based than it's conceptual based.
Yeah.
But I think sometimes if I want to make something,
mm-hmm.
I have to come up with solutions.
Yeah.
So And I don't really mind to make an effort for that. So it's not really practical always, because at some point I wanted to make a mosaic out of wood, and I only had a handsaw. So I would saw all the small pieces in order to make a mosaic. And at some point I thought, no, this can be faster. So I went to the hardware store and I bought an electric saw machine.
Yeah.
I don't know the English word.
Saw,
yeah. So then it went faster. Mm. And over the time I reconstructed, and my latest work is, well, it's actually based on windows, but it's again a mosaic. But this time I had some more budget, so I could laser cut it. And now I found a solution to make something really delicate and precise. Mm. But this whole process took maybe 5 years. And now I would learn about how wood works, how different tools, what kind of tools I needed. So I think this whole being practical with materials, that's always, for me, it's always the fun part.
Okay.
Because that's when you can make something. You already came up with a solution in your mind. I already imagined it, how it should be. And then you can just start to make it.
Mm.
And yeah, that's the building part. And that's always fun, because you know it's going to be, you know what to do at that point.
So you're really keen on technique in making it.
I don't know if I'm keen on technique. It's just a part of it.
Okay.
It's it's just a part of it, I guess. It will develop, and at some point it will be needed, so you have to.
Okay. So it's It's still serving some sort of imagination that you have.
The works I make are not about the, sometimes you have artworks who are about the technique.
Yeah.
And for me, it's more something that facilitates it.
Yeah.
It's not the main goal.
Yeah. Okay. So.
But it's something that I'm really get enthusiastic about. So yeah.
That's good. So how do you decide where an artwork should go?
It's the other way around. I see a space and I make it. So I usually work site specific, which is really, I mean, being an artist is already impractical, but this is also really impractical, because you always have to sort of make it on the spot.
Yeah.
But for example, if I would exhibit in a white cube, my work would be less abstract than when I'm exhibiting in, for example, the current exhibition that I have is in a old empty library.
Yes.
And there my work is more serene and more abstract, in order to sort of make a nice combination with...
So there's a sort of a balance between the environment and
your
work.
It's always part of it. Even, for example, if I make a painting, which I would consider the size... within the space. I would be willing to adjust the size of the painting if the wall needs that.
If that
makes sense.
Yeah, I get what you mean. By the way, they cut a piece of the Nachtwacht of Rembrandt
Yeah, for example. For the same reason. Yeah, no, yeah.
It's interesting.
It's a curating choice.
It's chop up. It's rather yeah. large, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, but that sort of suggests that an artwork is not autonomous in its entirety.
No, and also my works usually have to, because as I told earlier, it's my works are about the combination of materials.
Mm.
That's also what allows me to work abstract, so that it's more about the material, but also my works will be in relation to each other.
Mm.
So I make series.
Yeah.
And sometimes for an exhibition, I think the space needs a wall and I will build a wall, and then I would make a painting that fits that wall. And yeah, so that's how my work develops.
So I wonder, I've seen some of your work in a white cube, which is an art gallery,
mm-hmm.
typically. And I wonder, do you like to work with a white cube?
Yes and no. It's a different feeling, because in a white cube you can you get rid of all the noise around it.
Mm.
It can just, it's really peaceful, and it's almost like the pedestal for a sculpture, you know?
Yeah.
It's the right environment for it. But then if I usually work in spaces where I mean, it's when I feel the urge to make something, it's when I have the chance to make something for an old factory or a library, or the only impractical thing is that I can never sell it because it's made for the space and it can only be there.
Yeah.
So yeah, at some point I have to also make choices to make more works that would be more autonomous.
Mm.
But
well, you can yeah. sell a concept, and like a solovit, for example, which is a set of rules. And you can apply that set of rules to any wall, and you will get a sort of geometric
true.
Painting on the wall.
But I think the whole... I don't think I'm ready for that, because then I have to sell my rules.
Yeah.
And I want to make that.
Yeah, so yeah, you're a different artist.
And also I don't know yet what my rules are. I have some.
Is it... To what degree is your work instinctual, and to what degree is it intellectual?
I think I work more intuitive, but I mean, you have to feed your subconsciousness in order to do so.
Mm.
So it's always the process where you think of, first it starts with a conceptual or story, or for me it starts with a building, then I would look into what the space is telling me, or what the history of the space is telling me, or the shapes, and then I would, I don't know, these things will develop in your subconsciousness, and then I would come up with works.
So it seems to be the way you work seems to be a way to relate to the world around you.
Yeah, it does. Of course, it always does. Every art.
Not yeah. necessarily. It could be just an expression of your inner self.
Yeah, but also that relates to the outside world.
Sure. So yeah, okay, fair enough. You can't really, you can't make the argument that something is entirely disconnected from the outside world. But when you,
if it is, you don't have to show it.
For example, when I make, say I make a song about how I feel inside, and I play that,
yeah.
in the studio, and people can listen to that on their iPod, whatever, on Spotify, then that would be not so connected to the outside world. But if I go to a certain place and then I play reacting to that place, then I'm using the music to synchronize with myself in that place.
Or it's different, because if you would just write the song for yourself, if it's only for yourself, you don't have to share it, you don't have to play it.
True.
And you don't have to record it. But then when you make the choice to record it and share it, and people would listen to it, they can put their own feelings and their own context into it.
Mm.
So it's actually closer. It's actually, it becomes a part of someone else.
Mm.
So, I always choose to not explain my work too much in an exhibition, and people often feel the urge to ask me, like, why did you make it or what's it about?
Mm.
And I always tell people, like, first, just walk around and just tell me what you think. And my main goal usually is to, to create a sort of peaceful environment, like quiet. And but if I would tell people that, they would assume they have to feel that, and I don't want that. And sometimes I get reactions that for me are not that for me will not fit the artwork. But if it fits for them, it's fine. If it gives them something, and also if they don't like it, it's also fine. If it doesn't give them anything, it's
all
right.
It's always no problem. People assume that's hard to get the feedback. Well, I didn't like it at all, but that's not hard at all to get feedback.
It's fine.
It's fine, totally fine. You don't have to like it. There's no pressure on you to like it.
No, then look at something else.
Yeah.
Find something you do like.
Oddly enough, I rarely get a question like, why do you make this kind of music, or what is your purpose with this music? Nobody asks that from a musician.
Yeah, but it's because the music is more in the moment, and it's, I think, especially if you have people who aren't used to contemporary art, they feel certain distance, and there is a distance, there is this whole art bubble, and sometimes
there's also bad art sold as good art, because the bad art is made by the good artist, or it's just...
I don't know. I don't know if they're... I think...
Well,
I think is good, someone else can think it's bad. And I mean, that's the same way. Of course, there are rules, and there is the art scene, and there is the art world in which you have to relate to. Yeah. I think if I would have lived 100 years ago, I would make different works, of course.
Yeah, okay, but that's not really related to if something is good or not, or that there is distance within the art world. I wonder if the art world has more distance now than it used to have, because if you think about, I don't know, Picasso, for example, he was really outside of the normal world as well. People thought he was a bit crazy, and but then again, they did sell more, or maybe that's just the artists that we read about in history sold more because they're still around.
Yeah, there would have been plenty of artists who never
sold
got
anything,
the recognition.
Yeah. So that sort of seems, as a career guide, seems to suggest you just have to sell a lot.
Yeah,
that's why
I don't know.
Picasso was everywhere because he made so much.
No, yeah, you need to be recognized.
So, funny thing, museums really usually buy, when if they have an artwork by, I don't know, by Bartlett Newman, they have one. If they have Picasso, they have a series.
Yeah.
You can't go into a museum and find the Picasso. They're usually four.
I don't know. I never thought about that.
Yeah, Picasso's always...
Also, I don't like Picasso that much, but...
I don't like it that much either, and I don't think...
But it's just taste. That's, for me, it's just taste.
I would go further and say that not all of his work is good.
I don't know.
For me, that's... Yeah, I'm happy to be so judgmental as to put a value judgment on art.
Yeah.
Because... like, for example, if you listen to music, if people are listening to music and you ask them, would you prefer to listen to good music or would you prefer to listen to bad music? They say, oh, I'll have the good music, please.
Yeah.
So if you make a playlist of music that you consider good and bad, and across all genres, they would pick out some music they consider to be the good music and make a playlist out of that. So apparently they're and if you do that with a lot of people, some songs will get picked more often and some songs would get picked never. So apparently there's something like good and bad music. And music is art. If there's good and bad music, there's also good and bad paintings.
Well, there is, but I think... I don't really want to think about that, actually. Because why... Who am I to judge?
Who are you not to judge? Why wouldn't you?
Because if there, for example, as you say, there is bad music, if someone gets something out of that, it's enough.
Okay, so you say there might be value in a bad work of art.
Yeah, but is it bad then? It's just considered bad because it's maybe shallow or it's not prestigious enough. But then if you have like the good music, yeah, I don't know. It's not something you can sing along with, and that's fun sometimes as well.
Yeah, for example. So
I don't think this has to be a discussion at all.
Okay.
Not for me. No.
So when you make work, how do you differentiate between a successful artwork by you and a failure?
It's always temporary.
Okay. Did you ever throw something away that you regret destroying? A failed painting?
No, because I can always make it again.
Okay.
And if I can't, I would... hold on to it.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
But I think if you want to develop as an artist, my goal is to get better.
Mm.
And for that, I have to take risks in my work.
Yeah.
So... someone once told me, like, if you exhibit, that's always the part where you know how it should have been, but then it's already there.
Yes, that's definitely true.
And it's a good one because it's not an easy feeling to always have a critical look at your own work. Mm. For me, it's always really temporary that I'm happy about the work. But the moment that I don't think I reach the top, that's when I'm done.
Yeah.
So every artwork leads to a new work.
Yeah, so my suspicion is there is no end to it.
No. It's an ongoing process.
And that's of course also a good argument to defeat the value judgment of it, because it's just all part of a process.
It's part of a process, but it's an exhibition is maybe even the artwork is just a moment for me.
Yeah.
And sometimes I have works that I continue to like. Some works that I was really happy about, I look at now and I'm like, no, that would not fit my practice anymore. And sometimes if I'm a little bit lost, I would just remake the artworks that I liked,
mm-hmm.
and then make them better. Sometimes I just ideas that I had years ago, and yeah, then I would just go there again.
I sometimes rediscover all the music that I made, and then like, oh, it was actually quite good.
Yeah, you look with a you look in a different way to it, yeah. And yeah.
More objectively, sort of, because my ego is a bit out of the way.
But it's also that you need, for example, I need space to. Well, I made a lot of work this year, and now, although I really want to make new work and I have new ideas, I force myself to take some time to reflect on what I've made, because then I'm able to see what works, what didn't work, which way I want to continue. I need to reflect, be able to reflect on it, and I need to take time for that. And it's not really an easy feeling, because I really want to continue. Mm. But yeah.
So, but you're convinced that reflecting now is better than continue making and then reflecting when you feel like reflecting, or when you lose the urge to make.
I don't think I will necessarily lose the urge to make.
Okay, so you have to force yourself to reflect if you ever want to reflect.
Yeah.
I see.
Because if I lose the urge to make it, then there's no urge to it.
Funny. For me, the urge comes and goes. I can have like 6 months with no productivity at all, and also no regret of no productivity. And I can have very strong itch.
Yeah.
To make something.
Well, at some point, I had that in my practice as well, but I did at some point force myself to, and I still do that, to have a certain continuity.
Yeah.
Someone told me, like, it's like a muscle. You have to keep moving a little mm-hmm. in order to... It's...
Yeah, I think that one is true.
Yeah, so... Yeah, you have to... Get your brain in that.
In the mode of making. And for the listeners might have figured it out by now, but you make abstract art.
Yeah, installation art.
Installation art. And it's sort of in between a sculpture and a painting, usually.
Yeah.
And I wonder, why is it abstract, your work?
Yeah, I wonder that too, because I rather want to work figurative, but I don't, because at the end of the day, I'm searching for just making a gesture,
mm-hmm.
and... Yeah, I think over time my work became more abstract, and it took me a while to be confident about that, because I don't want the work to be prestigious. I don't want the work to have too much distance to its viewer. Mm. I want it to be close. And I think people relate easier to figurative works than to abstract work, but yeah, I don't know. Every time I would work more figurative, it felt that it was explained too much.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
And you also said usually when you make an exhibition, you want to create a space, a peaceful space.
Yeah, it's more the way that I curate the exhibitions, where I'm always thinking, okay, how would the viewer enter the room, and what would they see, and how would they move?
Mm.
And so my approach is to see the spaces or the works as sort of collage, where you can be a part of. And usually... I'm actually, and I feel more like a painter. But then at the same time, if a painting is on the wall, then the artwork only happens within the frame of the painting.
Mm.
Because we are used to we are used to look at it and understand, okay, the artwork is happening within this frame.
Mm.
But then if the painting isn't on a wall but it's in space, you can walk around it, and all of a sudden physically you can relate more to it. I feel that it can be bigger than you or smaller, and of course on a wall it's the same, but still if it's in space in or yeah, then all of a sudden the back is also important.
Yeah, it becomes an object.
Yeah, it becomes an object, and it will relate more to the other works as well. And yeah, that's where I think it's interesting. But then at the same time, I don't make sculptures because I think it was Elsbert Kelly who told in an interview that he doesn't like volume. And maybe that's the same with me, that yeah, I like things to be flat. Yeah.
Interesting. So you use the word relating a lot. So is your artwork seems to be a lot about relating to things. The human relationship towards spaces and objects.
Yeah. Fair. Yeah. But also being present. That's how it started for me, is that I thought you can miss so much if you just, for me it's really, I'm really used to really observe a room or and people I don't know. I started to make artworks for spaces related to the space in order to make the viewer more present. That was the starting point, I guess. And it still is, being present.
Is that where the material-based approach comes from?
It could be. Yeah, it could be. I don't know.
The word I've been thinking about our podcast, about your work, and I didn't say it because it doesn't seem to apply, but it keeps coming back, is tactile. Your work is it's very much inviting to be touched.
Yeah.
Except I never actually touched it.
Yeah. Well, no, but it is. It's also about that. And I don't mind if people do that. Well, some paintings.
You can destroy things if you touch it.
Yeah. But,
sort of the way you feature materials really has a sort of touching feeling to it, even though, yeah, it's so physical.
Yeah.
I guess. Even though you enjoy it visually, it's physical.
Yeah, but maybe that's why I wanted to be an installation, so that this physical part, that you can be a part of the installation, you can walk through it.
Yeah, you can relate to it more. It's interesting. So there's this very strong connection between relating to the work and how the work is shaped.
Yeah. About this tactile thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a new work I'm going to, or a new material I want to explore is the, and oh, I don't know the English word for it, but it's the dark green foam.
Okay.
Where you put flowers in.
Oh yeah, that one.
And it's always really nicely shaped.
Yeah.
But every store you go, someone pressed their fingers in it.
Yeah, yeah.
And you, it's like bubble wrap, you know, you have to sort of pop it.
It's sort of in between foam and clay, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just a weird material, and I like to this whole feeling the urge to touch it. And also I really appreciate the material in itself.
Mm.
I like the color, I like the structure. Yeah.
It comes out if you press it hard enough.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's a new material I want to work with. I want to explore.
That's a really good one.
Yeah.
I wonder what it will give us.
Me too.
Mm. Shall we end on that one?
Yeah, it's a good note to end.
All right. Emma, thank you so much for your time and talking to me.
Thank you for having me.
I really enjoyed it.
All right.